Simon & Schuster Audio presents The Girl Who Saw Heaven, A Fateful Tornado and a Journey of Faith by Lisa Reburn with Alex Tresniowski. Read by Nancy Peterson with Stephanie Einstein.
To Ari, for allowing me to join you on your very personal journey, and for giving me a better picture of the immediacy of the transition from this life to heaven. To Susan, for challenging me to be a better person as I observed you constantly maintaining the very picture of strength from such an uncommon place of humility and self-sacrifice. And to each of you who will read Ari's story and think about loved ones in your own life who have passed away. May the firm hope that Ari has of a living heaven also be yours. When you hear words like, they are in a better place, my hope is that you will recall Ari's experience as a little kindergartner watching her family, carefree and pain-free, immediately walking away from the tragedy that ended their earthly lives, and walking toward the indescribable beauty and love of heaven, where she knows she will see them again, soon enough. This book was written for you. Everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. Romans chapter 10, verse 13, New International Version. Chapter 1. We knew it was coming, and yet we didn't know. The afternoon of April 27th, 2011, Kenny Casey was on his way to fix a broken water pipe. Lean, soft-spoken, and 62, Kenny was a longtime resident of Arab, a small, mistakenly named town near where the Tennessee River dips into Alabama, about 70 miles north of Birmingham. Kenny had a bad hip and a stiff back from 40 years in the concrete business, but he could still build or fix just about anything. And when storms came through, which was often, Kenny was always ready to drive somewhere and fix something that wasn't working. That particular day began with squalls and thunderstorms blowing in from East Texas, and warnings from meteorologists that tornadoes were likely on the way, which in the South during tornado season was not that unusual. Tornadoes were just what happened in Alabama in the spring. Kenny set out in his blue Chevy extended cab pickup and headed for Arab Waterworks, the utility company on Coleman Road, and the site of the broken pipe. On the way, he switched on the radio, WXJC AM 850 on the dial, so he could listen to the weather. A tornado, he heard, was headed straight for Arab. Kenny knew he didn't have much time. Tornadoes move quickly, sometimes 60 miles an hour on the ground, fast enough to outrace a car. Most likely, Kenny had time to make one good decision and stick to it. He decided to turn the truck around and drive to the home of his mother-in-law in Arab's rural Ruth community, a quarter mile from his own home, to make sure she was okay. When he got there, the storm caught up to him. Fist-sized chunks of hail fell from the sky and shattered his windshield. Boards and branches flew past him like paper. Kenny rushed his uncle, niece, and mother-in-law into the home's concrete-topped storm shelter, tucked into a dirt hill beside the road. He stepped aside to let a truck race past him, just before pulling shut the shelter's heavy wooden door. Kenny took one last look at the darkening sky. What he saw could only make sense in a dream. Huge trees were flying through the air like bowling pins, he says. Then he heard the sound. People talk about this sound without knowing quite how to describe it. Deafening, sickening, unearthly. Sort of like standing next to an airplane turbine engine when you first crank it up, only 100 times louder. Kenny says. It sounded like the world was exploding. A fleeting glimpse of the thing was all he allowed himself before yanking shut the shelter door, joining his family in the cramped space, and beginning his prayers. Our Father, who art in heaven. 15 seconds later, it was over. Kenny opened the shelter and emerged into an eerie stillness. Graveyard quiet, he recalls. He never saw the tornado's black funnel, but he knew from hearing it that it had traveled over the nearby holler and through a large wooded field, land where he and three other families had their homes. Right then, he says, I knew my house was gone. He got in his truck and drove down the road, but broken trees blocked his way 100 yards from the field. From there, he had to go on foot. His hip was sore now, but adrenaline pushed him forward, and he crawled his way around mangled tree trunks and across the field. Finally, he was in it, the barren, flattened footprint of the storm. He stood there and surveyed the tornado's grim toll. An 80-year-old tree had been uprooted and dropped on his house, leaving nothing but a stew of wood and bricks. A stand of oak trees bordering the field had been mowed like grass, some yanked up, some sheared at the base. 100-year-old family barn behind his house reduced to a bramble of planks. A 2-ton pickup truck flipped over on its top like a toy. Around him, nothing stirred. No breath of wind or crack of wood. The familiar was now strange and new. The world was flat, and Kenny could see for hundreds of yards in almost any direction, though he couldn't tell which direction was which. Time had stopped, and the air smelled of dirt and grass and gas leaking from broken lines. A place of life was now a wasteland, stripped of everything. I was thinking, there's no way anyone could have survived, Kenny says. In the distance, a flicker of movement. Kenny limped his way toward it. In the middle of a field, in a clump of high grass, he saw something tremble. It was a child. Her eyes were closed and she was barely moving, but she was starting to come around, Kenny says. She was moaning like she was really hurt. I knew right away who it was. She was Ari Hallmark, the 6-year-old daughter of Kenny's friend, Shane Hallmark, and Shane's wife, Jennifer. Kenny, his hip and back nearly giving out, found the strength to lift Ari in his arms and cradle her. He held her like she was his own child, with her head on his shoulder. And later, he said no one could have taken her out of his arms, even if they'd tried. He knew Ari needed medical help, so he started walking. But he didn't know where to go. All the landmarks he was used to were gone. Instead, Kenny followed the sound of sirens. He carried Ari for nearly a mile, past the pockmarks of homes sucked whole into the air, until he made it up to Ruth Road. There, he saw a bright red fire truck and a fireman running toward them. Only then did Kenny surrender Ari. Wait, he said, before the fireman took her away. Kenny pulled off his red sweatshirt and gently wrapped it around Ari's neck, stabilizing her head. Then, as the fireman rushed away with the child, and as a hard rain poured down on the desolate scene, Kenny slumped to the ground, put his head in his hands, and prayed the little girl would live. He had no idea how badly she was hurt. All he knew was the tornado had thrown her across the black sky like a rag doll and set her down more than 200 yards away from where she sheltered. 2 football fields away. What she'd gone through in that time, Kenny couldn't possibly know. In fact, what happened to Ari in those terrible moments was something almost completely incomprehensible. Something beyond the storm, beyond all imagining. beyond even the confines of Earth. This is the story of Ari Hallmark and what happened to her. My name is Lisa Reburn, and I've known Ari since shortly after the super tornado outbreak of 2011, one of the deadliest and most devastating meteorological events in recorded history. What Birmingham-based TV meteorologist James Spann called an unspeakable American tragedy. It was the storm that brought Ari and me together. I first met her at the only five-casket church visitation I've ever attended. A visitation is an informal gathering of friends and family the night before the funeral, and the caskets held most of Ari's family. Like Ari, I'm a Southern girl, born in North Alabama. I grew up in the city of Florence along the Tennessee River, and about 24 of my relatives, aunts, uncles, cousins, grandparents, all lived within 3 blocks of my family's home. On Sundays after church, you'd find nearly all of us at my grandmother's house, gathered around the same tables, digging into home-cooked candied yams, fried okra, black-eyed peas, chicken and dressing, and my Aunt Helen's warm chocolate pie. Today, I'm a retired educator who worked in the Florida and Alabama public school systems for nearly 24 years, before earning my PhD and working 11 more years in higher education. One of my focuses has been on students who are blind or visually impaired. Occasionally, I have worked with young people during their times of.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.